Oh, you mean that in terms of infinity? Yes, so this will not go on forever because the bacteria will start dying out at some point. But there are other complications. Bacteria can also become resistant to bacteriophages. That's a different thing. But that's besides that, the, at the same time, right? So this assumes that every cycle the infection happens at exactly the same time and so on, and that is not going to happen. And after a while, you will start losing this synchrony, and then this will start to look like that. Okay? So that's a detail. Now, what this has now told you is that the bacteriophage has a nice some form of lifestyle inside the bacterium. Then the question emerged, is the form of the bacteriophage inside the bacterial cell, is it also capable of causing infection? That is, if I were to take the bacteriophage from inside the bacterial cell after it has entered it, right, took it out, can it cause infection? Is it a fully intact bacteriophage? This is a question. How will you now answer this question? And in other words, is the form of the bacteriophage inside the bacterial cell the same as the form in which it exists outside? The outside is the nice full bacteriophage that's capable of forming infection. Is that the same thing which is there inside? Does the whole bacteriophage get into the cell? The answer we know is no. But how will you, what again, what experiment do you think you can do based on these kinds of things to try and answer this question? There's only one difference between this experiment and that.
So just that, I think you're talking about the infection caused by a bacterium or the
bacteriophage infecting the bacterium.
Okay, as I said before, it is likely inactive outside the
bacterium. But how do you show it? You're looking at it inside.
After, you are drawing a graph that inside the bacterium it multiplies.
It multiplies, but is it capable of cause? If I took that form, will it infect another bacterium? That's the question.
You mean you are taking out the bacterial phage out of the bacterium? I don't think so. Because it attacks the bacterium and multiplies.
Yes, it's gone inside, right? Right now it has a life cycle inside the bacterium. Now, when it is inside the bacterium, is that a complete bacteriophage that is capable of infection, or is it a different form which inside? So again, we don't know the answer. How will you find out? Now this is the question that is burning everybody's head. So now I have to do an experiment to find this out. What will you do? It's very simple. Very simple. It's just one little change to this experiment. One very little change. And it's actually a silly little change. Yes.
I have a simple thought. Maybe we have a bacterium not inside the bacterial phage, not inside the bacterium. A small bacterial phage.
Which is this one.
Okay.
Which is what I'm measuring here.
And we can test out that what it will produce. What alternate will produce in another area or another chemical reaction or anything?
This very simple chemical reaction, can it kill the bacterium or not? It can. Right? That you have seen from this experiment.
Okay. And another bacterium, maybe the next bacterium which is inside the bacterial phage.
The other way around.
Bacterial phage inside the bacterium. Okay. And you know that we can take it out?
Yes. Perfect. So you do the same experiment. Instead of this thing which is floating around in the medium, you take the bacterium, break it open. There are ways by which you can break open a bacterium. Put soap into the crack, and then whatever comes from inside, see if it is able to create a similar. The such an experiment is done, and the answer is the form of the bacteriophage that is inside the bacterium is a non-infectious particle, and it depends on, to some extent. Some nuances are that it depends on which time point from this that I'm thinking. If I'm getting very, very close to this burst phase, then I have infectious particle. But till then, I don't. And then, electron microscopy came, right? You can see viruses. You could actually see the infection process going on. And then what found was that here is the bacteria, right? The bacteriophage, many bacteriophages look like this. Okay? And they look like little spacecraft, right? They come and with these little legs, they bind to some molecules on the surface of the bacteria. Okay? Now, it can even happen. This stuff is still there. So the electron microscopy, that there is this bacterium which has been infected, and this thing, this outer coat of the bacteriophage goes and sits there, and it just remains there. So that means that this bacteriophage is injecting something from inside into the bacterium, and this agent that it is introducing into the bacterium is something which is capable of producing 100 new bacteriophages. What it is injecting into the bacterium is genetic material. Okay? And this is initially is wonderful bacteriophage. This molecule does some magic and it's able to produce 100 different bacteria. And then a series of experiments were done. Let's not get into that. And those experiments showed that what this guy puts in, it's infected. Now what we do know after the work is that this is the DNA which comes in, and this DNA uses bacterial proteins, produce viral protein. And then viral protein form full viruses, 100 viruses, break the bacterium, come out, and each of these 100 will go target some other bacterium. So what we have seen now is that we have two streams of thought starting from somewhere. One was showing some obscure experiment, taking some bacterium, killing it, putting it, mixing with something else, and then making some observation. And the second one, this discovery of some agent which could kill bacteria. Both of these went in some funny directions. And then the many other segues that happened. It's not the only thing that these things led to. Many things happened. And one of those things that these experiments led to was the demonstration that DNA is the genetic material. Now we have viruses and so on where DNA is not the genetic material, it's in fact RNA and so on. But those are other complications. So this is just about DNA being genetic material for most organisms. And since this happened, we've come a long way. We knew how this DNA molecule looks like, right? Through X-ray crystallography. And we also learned how the DNA molecule is basically a code which can help in replication and also help in telling what proteins to produce, and which resulted in the idea that knowing the sequence, the DNA, will tell us a lot about what your organ is capable of doing. So, wanted to sequence the genetic material for various and movement towards that started in the 70s. Must have all heard of the Human Genome Project, which was fully sequenced around when we were babies, I guess. And that cost $1 billion and some 20 years or so of work. And today we can do the same thing for a few thousand rupees and in a matter of days. That is technological development that's happened in the last 10 to 15 years. And but what we did realize, to the shock of many and to the ecstasy of many others, is that knowing the sequence of the human genome or any other organism did not really solve any problems. It only opened up a whole range of new questions, primarily because the human genome, for example, doesn't seem to encode a lot more genes than, say, the genome of a fly or that of a fungus. So what is going on? And we still don't know the answer. And we thought sequencing the genome will tell us who will get into which disease and who won't get which disease. And then now we're starting to realize that even genetic diseases are multifactorial. Multiple mutations come together in interesting ways. And in some cases, we are now starting to find fairly strong associations. In other cases, it's iffy and so on. And as with many other things, we've had a major technological development, a major project, and instead of really solving a problem, what it has done is stoked our curiosity even more and told us there are 1,000 new problems to solve. One bacterial phage, 100 new bacterial phages now. There's one thing we've solved, and there's now 1,000 other things that we didn't know really existed, now really exist. Life becomes more complicated and more fun. So that's where we stand. Do you have any questions?
And I think that's about the DNA itself. And you are talking about DNA encoding and modification. And sir, you are telling that after the first, and DNA is made up of small monomers, I think nucleotides. And can you just explain how these traits are exhibited or kept in them, and they're just biomolecules?
Okay, so there are many ways in which the DNA can be modified. Okay, so at the end of the day, these are chemicals, right? And these chemicals come under various other environmental conditions. One of the most common ways by which DNA gets mutated is having reactive oxygen, like superoxide, so these can change one DNA base into a different chemical moiety, which can result in further errors downstream. So you end up with a few bases becoming something else. And when it becomes something else, one can end up producing, for example, a different protein, or change the levels to which a protein is produced in the cell. And the different protein, even if it is different at one or two points out of 500 points that it has, may have a different function, may become inactive, may become superactive, or may just do something else. So, and that's, for example, one way by which these mutations happen. And then, every time replication happens, right, you have a DNA molecule, it's made into two DNA molecules, and as it gets into the progeny cells. And this is a process which is being done by a protein machine, right? And as we all know, machines are never 100% perfect. These machines are a little bit more perfect than many of the machines that we may be making, but still, they make errors. Right? In a 1 in a billion, 1 in 10 billion cells that they may operate in, one cell may have an error. And then as we had this example, a billion and a 1 with the right variation here can take over the population. So there is a lot of randomness involved. And there are also certain types of sequences in DNA which increase the probability of replication errors. That is also possible. So many different ways by which these modifications happen. And some bacteria can also pick up DNA from the outside. Some of these bacterial phages are interesting. They come into the bacterium. They don't kill the bacterium. They don't want to kill the bacterium. What they want to do is that get their DNA and stitch their DNA into the DNA of the bacterium and then become part of the bacterium and live with the bacterium. And if the situation changes and it looks like the bacterium may not do very well and there are some issues that happen, then this will decide, all right, I'm getting out, kill the bacterium, go out. So, and in some cases, evolution happens and this bacteriophage that is sitting there may lose the ability to form a full virus again. So it becomes part of the bacterium fully. So it's, which is a modification. And sometimes, when the bacteriophage goes from one bacterium to another, it doesn't always take only its own DNA. It may also take part of the bacterial DNA and go transfer it to some other bacterium. So all of these create variation that is happening very, very rapidly. Yes.
My doubt was on that. These DNA, which was formed of monomers, nucleotides, which are just biomolecules.
Yes.
Okay. How does it code these traits, just like we are programming?
Oh, so how? Well, it's, you should, basically, if you see the cell as a big chemical factory, think many things get explained. Right? So still a lot of things that we don't really understand. So we are still trying to figure them out as we go along. But at the end of the day, the cell is just one big chemical factory. Thousands of chemical reactions going on. And every trait is the result of a series of chemical reactions. And if you're looking at the brain and so on, then it is a combination of electrical events as well as chemical events. So if the challenge really is at two levels. So how does a sequence of DNA result in a certain chemical outcome? So that means how does whatever the protein or something that it, the DNA results in, that it helps produce, perform a certain chemical reaction? And there is a whole lot of large number of people trying to answer those questions one protein at a time. And then how you have a thousand chemical reactions inside, maybe many thousands of chemical reactions inside a single bacterial cell, and how does it all come together to make sure that various things happen on time and that the propagation happens. And one will find that these proteins also set up nice regulatory switches and so on, which turn on and off at specific times. And we don't obviously know one answer to all of this. For each of this, there's a certain thing and it does something. And we are always trying to understand those things.
Searching about the human diseases, we are using white rats. Okay, white rats.
White rats, rats, yes.
Yeah, so why is any difference in the DNA? Or why, for what category they are being used as a research for human activity?
So, you can't easily experiment with humans, right? Will have a lot of problems doing that. Even if it is technically possible, there are reasons why you can't use it. And beyond humans, there are also a large variety of the most of the life on this planet that we have. We do not know how to work with it. Right? So what we instead often do is to create what we call as model organisms. So the choice of a model organism is also critical. So we are interested in trying to understand some phenomenon. And in terms of human disease, it could be a specific disease that affects us, or more broadly about the biology in general. Now for each of these kinds of questions, one has to identify a certain suitable model organism, which is a disease. Then we need to, one important thing that all models should be able to offer is the ability to perform a certain set of experiments. For example, can we do genetic manipulation? In many organisms, it's not that straightforward. In some organisms, it's fairly straightforward. And so can we do those kinds of modifications to try and answer a certain question? How easy to work with this organism in the lab, right? You can't do with, say, lions or tigers in the lab, right? So that sort of thing. So ability to work with, right? That's very, very important. And when you're thinking about human disease, in then can you create aspects of that disease in that or inside or whatever it is? If you can, then you are able to study that aspect in that organism, and then you can try and sort of do some, if possible, try to do that with human cells, not human organisms. So try to do these in human cells. And then if all of that eventually results in a drug, the clinical trial will take it to the human. But that comes at a very, very... And if you are trying to find some universal truth about life or so on, then your constraints are very simple. You just need to find an organism that you're comfortable working on and that you can do the kinds of experiments that you want to do on that organism. Easiest sort of things, bacteria, not all bacteria, E. coli and a few other bacteria are easy to work with. Some yeasts, the bread making yeast is fairly easy to work with. And then a lot of people work with fruit flies, where a lot of genetics can be done fairly easily. So these are some of the more common organisms to study universal processes. And then other mouse and so on gets closer to human.
Sir, it's in a recent study that has been published in American Journal of Sciences, it is said that luck plays a major role in causing cancer. So how does luck play a role in causing cancer? Almost 22 types of cancer is caused by luck.
So we do know that several cancers are caused by mutations. Right? Not all of these mutations are inherited. Correct? So it doesn't have necessarily have, we do have several hundred trillion cells, and if one cell by random chance catches a mutation, you're in trouble.
Sir, there are three factors, that is environment, heredity and luck. So how can luck cause a change or alter in general?
As we said, right, the replication machinery is not 100% perfect. When it copies the DNA, there is a very, very small rate of error. Right, every time it can, and that error is almost entirely random. Where those errors happen is almost entirely random. If an error happens and bad luck, it happens where it shouldn't happen.
കുറച്ച് കാലങ്ങൾക്ക് മുമ്പ് പത്രങ്ങളിൽ കേട്ടതാണ് സൂപ്പർ ബഗുകളെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് ഒരു ന്യൂസ്. എന്താണ് ഈ സൂപ്പർ ബഗ് എന്ന് അവയുടെ പ്രവർത്തനം എന്താണെന്ന് പറയാൻ
പറ്റുമോ? സൂപ്പർ ബഗ്സ് ആർ ബേസിക്കലി തിങ്സ് വിച്ച് ആർ റെസിസ്റ്റന്റ് ടു ആന്റിബയോട്ടിക്സ്. ആൻഡ് ആസ് വി മെൻഷൻഡ് അറ്റ് ദി വെരി ബിഗിനിംഗ്, ഇറ്റ് കംസ് ഡൗൺ ടു നാച്ചുറൽ സെലക്ഷൻ. ആൻഡ് വി very inadvisably have created an environment which is full of antibiotics, and natural selection favors bacteria which can survive these antibiotics, and superbugs are those which are resistant to multiple antibiotics. It's just normal evolution. And the truth is that if resistance, I'm quoting from this very old person called Julian Davis, who has worked a lot on antibiotic resistance, that if antibiotic resistance is biochemically possible, it will happen. There is no way around it. It will happen. The question is, how do we minimize it and how do we manage it? Yeah, yeah. And we just throw them everywhere. And so now normally it gets active in bugs which may not cause disease to us. But there are ways by which it can transfer the DNA from one organism to the other. And then if it gets into your salmonella or something, then you are in some trouble. Unless you find a very smart doctor.
Sir, can we make any bacteria which can decompose plastic?
I don't really know the chemistry of plastics and whether it's there, but I don't. The best place to look for will be some plastic dump, waste dump where these things are, and see if it can. But eventually, one thing we can is that given enough time and exposure to only say plastics as nutrients, they will do it. But you know, it's not possible for me to say whether it is feasible in any sensible time frame.
Sir, what do you mean by Zika virus? How it origin and what's the action against the human?
Actually, I don't know. I don't know much about Zika except that it's in the newspapers every day. Apart from that, I don't know much about it.
And how does the Ebola virus origin?
Well, the origins of viruses, you know, it's a lot of the infections that we talk about today, they say are zoonotic. That is, they are initially animal-related infections which find some mutation, find their ability to come into. And overall, across, if you look at human evolution over how many thousands of years, you will find that probably the kinds of diseases that we've had, some diseases have been there forever, and other diseases come and go. And again, natural selection plays a role. And I'm sure for some diseases, there may be the parameters which resulted in the rise of a disease is probably known, but you have to find the right literature for that. Yeah, they mutate very rapidly. So there is always a very constant arms race of sort that's going on between bacteriophage and bacteria. Bacteria try to become resistant to bacteriophages, and bacteriophages will try to evade the resistance mechanism to find a way back into the bacteria. But always happens.
I don't know whether my opinion is right. Can we use the genetic engineering or gene modification in defense?
In defense? Well, I don't know anything about defense. It is to really... Well, I don't know. You may probably want to bring together a genetic engineer and an army general or someone to discuss that.
Bacteriophage
would be king.
What she's asking is that you told us that bacteriophages only infect bacteria. So can bacteriophages be used to battle bacterial infections in humans?
So there is in fact a long history of this happening in Georgia. So this guy, T. Henel, was one of the two people who discovered bacteriophage. He initially talked about bacterial phages as a therapy, and then he set up this institute in